And even before they head back to the negotiating table, the public will be glad to know that the government peace panel has already done its homework. Its members visited Navarra in Spain for what some may call a study tour. While power is highly decentralized in Spain, a country which has been called a state of autonomies, here 17 autonomous communities and two cities are actively practicing self-governance.
Now, the anatomy of autonomy, this is the lesson the Philippines hopes to learn from Spain, from how an autonomous police force fits into the national context, to how power and wealth should be shared. But of course, how well and how fast can the Philippines learn is a different ballgame altogether. And just a reminder, they have less than 2 months to go before the target completion dates for the annexes.
And to discuss with us that study tour of Navarra, we're joined here in the studio by Muntinlupa Representative Rodolfo Viasan, who was part of that Philippine delegation that went to Navarra, Spain.
Congressman Viasan, of course, is the chairman of the House Committee on National Defense and Security and is a member of the Peace, Reconciliation and Unity Committee. And as always, you can send us your comments and suggestions and questions as well through Twitter using the hashtag Primetime, or post them on our Facebook page. That's ANC247. Congressman, good evening and thanks for joining
good
us
evening,
tonight.
Good evening, Carmina. Good evening, Tony.
Buenas noches.
Buenas noches.
I mean, you must have picked up a few Spanish sentences while you were there.
Chapagano accent.
Chapagano. How long did you stay in Navarra?
Well,
Who did you talk to?
A little over 10 days, about 12 days, I think, to include some non-working moments, like when we made the tour to Toledo. Mm. But
such
our working moments were in Madrid and Navarra, or more specifically, its capital, Pamplona, where you have the bull running of the bulls.
Yeah.
You know, I think there were over 20 of us who were there. Two congressmen, myself and Congressman Sakdalan, chairman of the Peace Unification and Reconciliation Committee, and then Senator Gingona, who is coming from Mindanao, of course, and then five governors, all the five governors of the ARMM were there.
Okay.
And then, of course, the whole staff of the whole panel, the OPA panel, headed by Secretary Deles.
Mm. Who did you talk to during your working trip?
There were presentations from ministers, there were presentations from mayors, there were presentations by non-governmental groups to teach us. You know, Spain, as you have mentioned, is composed of 17 autonomous regions.
Mm.
But what is peculiar is that no two autonomous regions have the same power relative to sharing with the central government. Meaning,
so they don't have a pro forma.
That is correct.
To
suit
there
and fit
the
localities, the regions,
mm-hmm.
so that there are regions that are almost fully autonomous, but there are also regions that still depend
on the central government,
the state they call. So their constitution provides for this, and what is important for us is we have a whole range of autonomous regions to choose from, or a combination of two or more of them, to suit our own situation. For example, in the upcoming debate on this proposed law creating the new Bangsamoro political entity, we will have to debate on at least four contentious issues. The first one will be debated on is what will be the form of that local government unit. Will it be ministerial as they are asking, or will it be the same as the present regional and provincial governments?
Okay.
We will have to debate that. Second, the sharing of political power between central government and local government. For example, we have to debate on what political power should be exclusive in the hands of the national government. What power should be a shared one between central and autonomous regional government, and what power will be in the hands of the autonomous government?
Correct.
Similarly, we have to debate on the sharing of wealth. Taxes, for example, yung natural resources, for example. For example, in Spain, there are taxes that is in the jurisdiction solely of the national government. They collect it, and it is only
for
use of the national government. There are taxes that are collected that is shared between central government and the local government. And there are taxes that are collected and used solely by the autonomous region. You know, there is another one that I may add, and this is the Autonomous Region Police Force. Early this evening, I was listening to your station, radio station, and there was a mention of a denial by the Director General of the PNP that there is a recruitment of Autonomous Region Bangsamoro Police. They deny, of course, there is no such thing at this point in time, not yet. What I noticed there, and I asked a question on this among the Spanish authorities, is, do you know that there are four levels of police forces in Spain? The national, the autonomous, the provincial, and the municipal. What is important is, if we go down to the lower three, autonomous, provincial, municipal, the power to hire and fire the policemen are in the hands of these three chief executives. Meaning, if a new mayor comes in, he fires all the policemen of the previous mayor, previous administration, and hires his own. And there is no limit to the number. Can we adopt this here? I don't think so.
I don't think so, judging
because,
from the history of the region.
You are giving a structure for the organization of private armies.
Right, right.
And private armies is one such bane to our society in some places, not only in Mindanao, diba? But including.
I want to ask you though, Congressman, you mentioned all of these things that must be debated on. This is a must, actually. Form of government, sharing of political power, sharing of wealth, and the police force. Might I also add the judicial jurisdiction, which belongs to? Do you think that's also something that should be debated
on? Well, to a certain extent, probably, because in Spain, judicial jurisdiction is the national. It is the national that appoints, for example, the judges. And of course, criminal law is the same all over. Our concern may arise if we talk of the Sharia court. I think, especially if the Sharia court will be given jurisdiction on legal issues that is not contained within the national judicial processes, criminal law. For example, the issue of marriage na lang.
Adultery, concubinage.
Exactly. So, but somehow, right now, that this is allowed under Islamic law, that one can have as much as
three wives.
Four.
Or four.
Four wives. And so, this can come to be a little ticklish. But I think, on the main part, criminal law, I should say, should be the same for all. Reason, what is crime to some parts of the Philippines, or the national sin, and committed in the same, should be the, because of the mixture, for example, of religion, the mixtures of culture, there can only be one criminal law that we have to enforce. But again, as I said, this is going to be subject to the law that will be crafted by Congress. Mm-hmm. You know, I have one, if I may, I have one suggestion to all, the executive department, the legislature, those who are involved in the fast-tracking of the proposed law that is supposed to be drafted by the Transition Commission as in accordance with the framework agreement. The only function of the Transition Commission as structured is to draft that law. And that law will be submitted to us for constitutional enactment of it into law. Now, when will this be? I would say this 15th Congress cannot anymore tackle that. We have run out of time. It's now the election period, and then January, that's it. After on January, we go to the election period recess, which is going to be a long time. Yeah. So I say that the Congress that will tackle the crafting of this law will be the 16th Congress.
16th now.
16th Congress. Mm-mm. But you have to consider one thing, one factor here.
Which is?
After the elections, that there could be new faces of congressmen. There could be new faces of senators.
So you're saying the support that it has now may
exactly,
not be the
may
same
not be.
During the 15th,
that
the
is
16th
correct.
Congress.
For example, you know, what's the day today?
November 12th.
12, 2 days from now. It will be the 40th year, November 14th. The first clash between MNLF and government occurred November 14, 40 years ago, 1972. And, you know, since then a lot of soldiers died, a lot of rebels died. I can accept the death of soldiers because this is their job. I can accept the death of rebels because they chose it by being rebels. But what about the death of 150,000 civilians? We need to hope, we need to pray, we need to work so that this struggle will be put to an end. And that's why I support this very, very. But the one thing, if I may, no? I am recommending that we fast track the drafting of that law to be submitted to us, and I am recommending that as soon as it is recommended to the 16th Congress, it immediately post haste debate on it. I would like to see the day when that law is enacted into law, not later than mid 2014. Reason? There will be required transition before you come to an election in 2016 for the officials of the new Bangsamoro political entity. And I would like to see that this president, President Aquino, will be the one to supervise the implementation of the transition period. Because President Aquino is so focused on this. And it's his...
That's going to be his legacy.
His program. And it's going to be the legacy. The danger of that law not being enacted at that time is that during the transition period, baka po hindi pa tapos yung transition, pumasok na yung bagong administration, which is not attuned to this process.
Do you see that possibility taking place in 2016? Because, the way political figures are shaping up already, you can more or less predict who might be in Malacanang by 2016. Do you feel that prospective administration might not be as receptive to the ideas that are being discussed now?
I don't have the feeling at this point, but this is a concern. Mm. This is a concern that I hope it doesn't happen. I hope that there is a full measure of time that the President Aquino is given for the transition period. For him to be able to supervise the transition period.
Because I'm curious, though, because now that you're saying that President Aquino is so focused on this program, that, as Casey pointed out, it will be his legacy, and you're concerned that the prospective new administration in 2016, and of course, you know, we see who politically has the cachet to actually reach Malacañang.
I think I know where you're leading to.
I know. And his group, or the leaders identified with that group, are actually so, how do you call it, so opposed to having peace with the MILF before they raided the camps and all that, that might be the same philosophy this new administration might bring.
Difficult to say. Let's just suffice to say, this is a concern that we must address. And that it is better, I think, that this law is enacted with providing for a long transition period that can be supervised by President Aquino.
Okay. Congressman, I want to go back to the learnings from your visit to Spain. Now, you mentioned a while ago that there were a lot of combos when it came to the how they see autonomous in the different 17 autonomous communities. Ibang mixture sa iba, may siguro 70% fully autonomous, yung iba hindi naman ganon. Now, but you also mentioned that this whatever mixture they have there is enshrined in their constitution. The constitution allows for that. Yeah. Now, do you think that here at home we would have to revisit our constitution and possibly amend it to have a formula that will really work for the Nubang Samoro political entity?
I hope not, because that will complicate matters. That is the reason why my advice to this panel, even in the very start, is that be careful about what you grant, because there are demands that can be granted within the powers of the chief executive, but there are demands that can only be granted by Congress. And further, there are demands that not even the President or Congress can grant, because the authority to that is the people, the sovereign supreme, the sovereignty of our people, in the form of having to ratify any proposal to amend the constitution. That could complicate matters. Because you are not only looking at the possibility that any proposal to amend the constitution can go any of the three ways of amending constitution: people's initiative, constituent assembly of Congress, and then constitutional commission. It could, depending on the gravity of the proposed amendments, we may have to go all the way to a constitutional commission. I hope not, because that will, as I said, complicate matters. And it will, as a matter of fact, if, for example, we have to address the question, what will happen? Instead of Congress just addressing the crafting of the law, we will have to be sidetracked by having to address the problem of having to amend the constitution.
Which brings me to my next question now. Is the Spain model doable in the Philippine context? Remember, Spain is highly developed, much more developed than the Mindanao region. Can we make it happen, judging from what you saw?
Again, as I said, there are 17 models we have to choose from. That's the problem. You know, for example, the most advanced autonomous region is Navarra, ang capital niya, Pamplona. In Spain, there is a 25% unemployment, and is still increasing. Unemployment.
Especially now, yes.
Right. Navarra has only 7% unemployment. Navarra has direct relationship with the rest of Europe.
So they're allowed that?
Exactly.
But Congressman, okay. I have to ask, maybe from a historical perspective, and it's something that we have to consider when we try to address the issues in Muslim Mindanao. I mean, we're coming from many decades, a period of conflict, right, where we're trying to
Four decades.
We're trying to use the issue of autonomy as a peace mechanism, right? But when these autonomous regions in Spain came to be, did they have to resolve any conflict, any wars before they reached that stage? Or did they develop peacefully on their own?
Except for one, the Basque region.
Bilbao.
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you know that up until now, there is no agreement for disarmament?
Yes. Mm. Yes.
But they are now. They have, ETA, ETA has given up the armed struggle. Mm. But the arms are still with them. Question, shall we adopt the same thing?
Mm.
But there are some differences. For example, when you talk about DDR, disarmament, demobilization, reintegration, you know? This is going to be affected by one thing. Not only one thing, but to me, the most. RIDO.
Oh, again. The blood feuds.
RIDO, how do you address this?
Mm-hmm.
Do you immediately disarm? Remember, in 1972, upon the declaration of martial law, there was a government directive for us to effect disarmament.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There was no MNLF left yet at that time.
Mm-hmm.
When, in November, the government started trying to disarm,
that's when it started.
In Jolo, the different groups.
Yeah.
November 14 was the first class.
And
the MNLF was born.
And this is the reason why you had answered the way you answered to Tony's question a while ago about the particular party that he was referring to. Because it is a concern that it may just happen. History might just repeat itself.
That is the reason why this transition commission that is supposed to draft the proposed law, I would advise a widespread consultation. Consult with the political leaders. Yeah, yung limang governor yan, dapat. I am even proposing a consultation with religious leaders, the ustads, the ulamas, maybe even the traditional leaders of the Islamic community, the tatus, the sultan, and of course, I'm not even mentioning yet, yung leaders of the peripheral provinces that may be affected by what we do. For example, Lanao Norte. The MILF is asking for 6 municipalities of Lanao Norte. Ibig sabihin, 6 municipalities of Lanao Norte gusto lang isama sa kanila. But of course, that will be subjected to a plebiscite. So, there must be a widespread consultation. Para, you know, as I said, I even suggested the MNLF should also be consulted. Remember, we have a standing agreement with them.
The
MNLF. Except that I would like to say something here, if we have time. Ms. Wari, people are thinking that he still represents the MNLF.
What? Which people?
No more.
No, which people are thinking like that?
Those who generally do not know
what's happening.
What is the status of Ms. Wari? For example, in 1999,
because he says the MNLF was the only one recognized by the OIC.
No, not anymore.
How?
1999, some members of the Central Committee came to me. 1999, they were asking for an audience with President Erap, and I asked why. Because we will ask Erap to oust Ms. Wari as governor of ARMM. And I said, the president cannot do that. Mm-hmm. Because Misuari is supposed to be, quote-unquote, elected.
Yeah.
So he cannot do that. Mm. But the first step is for you to consider should he still be the chairman of the MNLF.
Mm.
If he is not anymore and should not be anymore, sino makakagawa niyan? Yung Council of 15.
Nila.
Yeah. And I was even invited to go to Jampiras. Sabi ko, bakit? For you to talk to our Council of 15. I said, hindi ko na kailangan niyang gawin. Kayo. Mag-usap kayo. And so eventually, the Council of 15 removed Misuari as chairman of the MNLM. So my question, or the question of many people, does Misuari still represent the MNLF as a group?
Mm-hmm. Or even the Bangsamoro people.
Yeah. Maybe he can represent the group, but not anymore the whole MNLF. Mm-hmm. This is what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
But you cannot also disregard him. I think he should be included among people who should be consulted.
Well, a fascinating discussion with you, Congressman Biasan. Even the fact that you pointed out that the anniversary of the first clash of the MNLF, I mean, history would probably have already forgotten all about it.
Yeah.
It's a good thing that you actually put that in perspective for all of us. We have to finish the interview. We'd like to have you back some other time. many times, of course, over the period that we're talking about this issue. The next step I think would be to have the lessons from your study tour put into a report, right?
Well, I'm only one of them.
Yeah.
You know, the five governors, mm-hmm. Senator Gingona, Congressman Sakdalan, and of course the whole OPAP, Marvick Leonen, etc., etc. They will have their own ideas, and I do hope that there will be a synthesis, so that we can speak with only one tongue.
Right.
Mm.
What cannot happen is we speak different.
See, you've got to have one report where all of your views are distilled into.
They after all, had 17 models to choose from.
They just visited one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they must agree on just one.
Oh, you two.
Madrid and Navarre.
Navarro.
Okay.
Navarra.
Pero Navarre yung sinasabi ang tawag nila doon.
They call it Navarre. All right. Well, Congressman Biasan, thank you very much for sharing with us your experiences during that trip and, of course, your invaluable historical insights into this matter. Nobody else has that kind of wealth of knowledge as you have. Thank you very much.
May I just say something? No?
Yeah.
Thank you for the ABS-CB and in behalf of my constituents. Because when I was
distributing... Hindi na sa Navarra to, ah.
Hindi na to. Wala ka ng constituents sa Navarra.
I was distributing relief goods to about 300 families that
victims of a fire.
Yeah. The other night,
mm-hmm.
nandoon yung ABS-CBN kaya doble na tanggap nung so in behalf of my constituents, I would like to thank ABS-CBN for that.
Well, the people behind the ABS-CBN Foundation at Sagip Kapamilya always glad to help whenever a crisis like that happens anywhere in the Philippines. Congressman,
thank you
again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.